morning, church. I'd like to invite you guys to stand as we worship our risen King this morning.
quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Come on and pray.
Verse 22 says, cast your burdens on the Lord, release it, and he will sustain and uphold you. He will never allow the righteous to be shaken. He'll never allow you to slip, fall, or fail. Amen.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Who breaks all power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, only you, Jesus, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King of all. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life.
Chaos
who brings our chaos back into
Can we just sing that chorus one more time? Let's sing this to him. This is amazing grace. This is what it looks like. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life.
You lay down your life.
That I would be set free.
Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Lord, we just thank you for who you are, God. For all that you have done for each and every one of us. You paid the ultimate price, and we can stand here today and rejoice because you fulfilled your promise, and you are alive indeed. Lord, you are worthy of our praise. So worthy, God.
Was my cross you bore so I could live in the freedom you died for? And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name. Worthy. Goes on, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Exalted now in the heavens, as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. Through the name above all names, oh, be Thank you, King. We thank you, our King, our Savior, our Lord. Exalted in heaven and on earth. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord. We confess this morning that you are Lord. You are King, Jesus. Mighty is your name. Love you so much. We fix our eyes on you this morning. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Morning, church. Hey, this might be on. Hey. God bless you guys. So if you open your Bible app today, it's going to say, he is not here, for he has been resurrected, just as he said, come and see the place where he lay. Just as he said, that part has been getting to me, because Jesus tells us what he's doing and what he's going to do, doesn't he? He told his disciples he was going to rise from the dead. What did he do? Right? And he tells us he's going to come back, so he's going to. Amen. And then who are we in that story? Who are we in that picture? I'm going to invite the ushers up. We're his servants. We're the ones he gives us instructions to. And he tells us to support the kingdom. He tells us that we have been entrusted for a time to serve him. All of us. If we are believers in Christ, we are part of his kingdom. And if he's the king, we're not. He also says in Luke, he says, why do you look for the living among the dead? Too often, we look for the living among the dead in this world, right? And I think for each one of us, that is something that we can think about this week, is how do we look for the living among the dead? Are we going to graves to try to resurrect something that is already alive? And we can find it in Christ? As a church, we give. As a church, we support the ministry of what the kingdom of God is doing in the mountains. And we're not the only church up here. So if this isn't your church home, we're not asking you to give. If you want to give, I am not telling you not to be generous either. somebody told me, oh, you can't do that. I said, don't tell me what I can give. I'll do it if I want. Yeah, we're all servants, right? Yeah. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a great God and you have given us Jesus, who is alive, who is consistent, who keeps his word, who tells us what the future will like and it unfolds, who has invaded our hearts. We give you the glory today. We give you the glory for the resurrected Savior that has taken us from the kingdom of darkness and brought us to you, to your presence in the kingdom of light. Let these words not just be words. Let them be your words, and you've said them, so they're true. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. Hey, give it up for Andrew Osley. He's our creative pastor here. And make sure you thank this whole crew over here who put in countless hours, because he's worthy. So I know that you guys don't know, but this praise team came here multiple times. Can we just send them a little bit of love? I love you guys, man. There's many components that come into what church is. And if you're new with us today, I really felt like Easter is a homecoming. Have you guys ever been to homecoming? Man, it's great. I mean, there's always that guy that like keeps retelling his old football stories. Not that. I'm talking about when you come home and you feel celebrated, you feel welcomed. Already this morning, I was able to see some old friends, see some folks that I haven't seen in a while, and so happy Easter. He's risen? He's risen indeed. I am in love with Easter because it is the celebration, it is the high holy day, and though Christmas is a month long, Easter is like really quick. It's really certain, it's really fast, it makes an entrance. It shows up, and all of a sudden it's here. You guys know spring has sprung, right? That it's here. I know, because some of you guys are already thinking about weed eating and what you have to do around the property and all the things. But Easter is that culmination, that celebration, that it is now going to become the brightest season. It's going to bring light. It makes an entrance. Last week in the church calendar, we celebrated the triumphant entry. The triumphal entry is that of Jesus coming into Jerusalem, and then you have this phenomenal moment where you realize he makes an even grander entrance on Sunday. On the resurrection Sunday that is Easter, this celebration on the Lord's Day, he rises from the grave, and he has been doing it ever since in our lives. Are you with me? I know you're here, but are you with me that this is a great thing to celebrate, that we serve a risen Christ? Not someone who is in a tomb, not somebody who, oh, I told somebody that told somebody. No, This is our testimony. We bear testimony that there is a risen Jesus that transformed our lives. And if you've yet to come into relationship with him, you have a chance today to lean in and say, God, how do you make an entrance into my life? I love when people make great entrances. Have you ever seen a really good entrance? You know, and I'm not talking about like the old school Dick Van Dyke tripping over the thing. No, I'm talking about when a grand entrance is made. A wedding day. You ever seen a wedding day entrance? And have you ever tried to make an entrance, though, and failed miserably? That it all of a sudden just, it falls flat, or you try to make it about you. That's when you really know when a great entrance kind of falls flat. There's certain things you should do when trying to make an entrance. One, you consider the situation before you show up. I showed up here once for a funeral, and I was still in my pajamas. No, I wasn't pastor at the time. I was a youth pastor. I'm just waking up late on a Saturday, man. It wasn't my job, but there was this moment of, oh my gosh, I am not dressed for the occasion. You ever felt that? This was way more formal than I thought. Don't be late is another way that you make a great entrance, is you don't show up fashionably late. Now I know we'll probably have a few people linger in, and that's great. If you like snuck in the back, welcome. I'm still glad you're here. But when you want to make an entrance, you respond with proper emotions to the situation. So when you show up, you respond with the proper emotions. We showed up to Easter. If you walked in here solemn and sad or heavy, you've yet to meet the risen Christ who does this amazing thing where he takes dead things and makes them alive. And so the idea of this is your yearly reminder that Jesus is alive. And that's not for people who came to church for the first time or for those who, because here's the deal. They're already here because they know Jesus is alive. Sometimes you need to remind the church that he is alive. Right? You need to remind the church that he is alive. See, there was no response to that, which is a reminder the church needs to know that Jesus is alive. Okay, because if my God is alive, it's worthy of celebration. That you pause sometimes before making entrance and you gather your thoughts, that you look at others in the room. You don't make it all about you. You want to make a real entrance, you look to others. That you pause briefly, you look to others, and then you determine you're not the center of attention. Now, this is hard because immediately as I bring this up, you're going to start thinking about yourself. That when you realize I'm not the center of attention, that it's okay, all of a sudden I can relieve myself of that responsibility of being the center of focus. And then finally, look as if you enjoy being there. Right? Welcome to Easter Sunday, right? And I don't know if it's my sermon or what, but man, are you here? I'm here. And I love, there's Krispy Kreme in on the way. I was up on the church late last night, literally up on top throwing this purple sash. I've never felt more alive. I'm like, I'm gonna die. I looked at the guy that was with me, and I was like, hey, if I fall, you're preaching tomorrow, so. But how did you make an entrance when it comes to Easter? How did you make an entrance? When I look at Easter morning, we show up in our finest apparel. We make an entrance. We want to feel that moment of celebration. And I want to tell you, you're not the center of attention, but you are the object of his affection. Okay? That's not just a catch line. That's not just something for the pastor to say so that you remember something. You were the object of his affection. You were why he went to the cross. You were why love could not be contained in the grave. His eyes are fixed on you. No matter if you make church a normal attendance or if this is just an Easter Sunday, that he has set his focus on you and he says, for you, I love you. And so I felt like really the Lord wanted me just to introduce you to Jesus. So whether you've been in church for a long time or not, this is always a good word. Come to me, all you who are heavy laden, all who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. That is the heart of the one you meet today. No matter if you've walked with them for 20 years or it's your first time saying, I want to follow, fall in love with that man. I want to know who that is. He is gentle and lowly in heart. You will find rest for your souls. Anybody want rest? Anybody tired? And not just physically tired, I mean soul tired. Because it's one thing to celebrate Easter. He is risen. We just keep going through the motions. He is risen. Okay, but what does that mean for me today? My soul is tired. I'm burdened. I've been laboring. I'm heavy laden. I'm exhausted. What does Jesus do in his risen state for me today? Because it's not enough just once a year. I want to celebrate that he is alive every day, that he gives me rest for my soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And this the church needs to remember. This every single one of us needs to remember. Jesus doesn't make it about anything other than the fact he gives you grace. He gives you love. He gives you a sense of, man, I have worth and value because he laid down his life for me, that there is new life. You know, I was texted this morning talking about Jesus is risen, right? We know this nomenclature, like he is risen. He is risen? Indeed. But I got the Z version, the Gen Z version today. My buddy texts me, he's like, Jesus, he has the riz. I'm like, oh, no. Stop. Just stop, man. So in 20 years, you're going to realize, like, that's how everybody's greeting each other in church on an Easter morning. But when you show up on Easter, what is it? Is I'm just looking for somebody charismatic? Am I looking for somebody that has that, like, attention, or do I have his attention? I realize that, man, if you walked in this place, you want to know the heart of Christ and his heart towards you. You are met with a heart that is gentle and lowly. What that means is that who Jesus is, his heart for us, his heart towards us, how does his heart respond when he sees you? He responds gentle and lowly. He responds with invitation. He responds with, I don't care about your church attendance. I want you to know my heart for you is that I celebrate you. I died for you. I rose again for you. You are the object of his affection. How does he make entrance into our lives? How does Jesus make entrance into any of our lives? We can tell stories. We heard a great testimony at Sunrise Service. Unbelievable. Skylar just stood up and just bore testimony. And it was so powerful because for those who are discouraged on Easter, for those who are frustrated, for those who are cynical or weary or empty, people who are heavy-hearted, Jesus meets us and says, I am gentle and lowly in heart. That means he's down on your level. He comes to your place of understanding and says, I want you to know my heart. It's one thing to be introduced to a man. It's one thing to be introduced to somebody. But when they start to reveal their heart to you, who they really are. See, we can learn so much from the story. All that is in Scripture, the four Gospels, we can learn about how Jesus was born into a dirty stable or manger. We can learn about, man, the ministry, the public ministry of Jesus, or even the really messy disciples, which we forget that they were messy. And so then we show up at church looking for perfect ones, and we forget the story is about the messy ones. We can learn about, man, that Palm Sunday is more than just Jesus arriving in Jerusalem through a mercy gate. That's what it was when he walked into Jerusalem, the city of peace. He walked in through the gate of mercy. We need to remember that Jesus also invites us in, because of his mercy, into a place of peace and rest. What do I invite you to? Is not just to say he is risen, but to believe it in your heart and know that he's gentle and lowly towards you. So you can come to church and you can hear all the teachings. I've been doing this long enough. I know the teachings, but do I know his heart? It's more than captivating an audience or trying to get your attention and have like a good hook. It's about understanding his heart. The heart of Jesus is gentle and lowly. His teachings, his prayer life, the miracles that have happened and can happen. We show up at church because we don't want to just hear the teachings. We want to see people living out these teachings of Jesus. We want to see these things in action. That we can read about his arrest and his excruciating death. But most importantly, what seemed like such a grand entrance, that God's grand entrance into human history, though it was subtle and obscure, it was quiet. He didn't grandstand. He was always constantly bringing other people up and lifting them up. You can only lift people up if you are gentle and lowly and invite them in. He is risen. See, we see the cross and we see it as almost like this this abrupt exit. And if you've seen people that make an entrance but they don't know how to leave, you've hosted a party. Or people that can't sustain that energy. They show up, they're the flash, and they show up, and then all of a sudden it just... No, but Jesus, in his subtlety, shows up subtly, right? Subtly, he shows up, and all of human history has changed. Look around for a moment. When I see the church, I don't just see a bunch of people in pews. I see lives changed. And I wish you knew all these stories. I wish you could look around and see the stories of people whose lives were changed because Jesus showed up and he sustained a transformation in human history. And so we see an abrupt exit. It seems like it's dripping with defeat, but really he's saying, I'll be right back. Right? Jesus knows how to make an entrance. And we celebrate the astonishment of a resurrection. We can hinge our faith on an actual historical moment. You guys, look at me. All of the disciples went to their deaths because of their testimony. Not because of their belief, not because of their faith, not because of they were following some guy. They went to their deaths because of their testimony. Do you understand? You have his testimony. You have a testimony that Jesus changed your life. So there's millions of pages of written by theologians, and man, there's New York Times bestsellers and podcasts and long drawn out sermons. But all we want, all we really want is to understand his heart and to see what we're invited into. That when he makes an entrance, he invites us in. We can enter in tired and worn out, wounded. We will be met with a heart that understands us. We'll be met with a God who says, I want you to live freely and lightly. Does anybody want to live freely and lightly? I keep carrying way too much weight. I take myself, everybody who comes to church here understands this, I take myself way too seriously. Way too seriously. But I think this matters. But I know that the best way to preach is not the way I'm preaching, but the way I'm living. Man, I'll never forget a guy my sister grew up with. She and him were talking and said, every time I see Michael driving around, he always looks so worried. He always looks so worried. Why is he always so worried? And so it reminded me, no, I need to celebrate. I need to remember, man, that my face preaches the gospel more than my words, right? And so, man, to live freely and lightly. If you came in here and you feel like this is going to be another burden on you, another tradition to fulfill, another, you know, box to check, no, live freely and lightly. He wants you to feel that sense of lightness. See, Jesus opens his heart up to us. If you want to be faithful to the teachings of the Bible, Jesus, when asked, like, what is his heart? How is he towards us? He's the one that gives this teaching. You can refute him. You can argue with him about it. But he's the one that says, this is how I am, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. You will find rest for your souls. That's the promise. You want to know the heart of Jesus? I love this. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The responsibilities, I don't need to unburden myself to get with Jesus. My youth pastor used to always say, you don't need to take a shower to get in a bath. Right? You don't need to clean up to come to church. You don't need to like get it all figured out. None of us here have it figured out. More of you need to say amen. I know you, okay? I know you. None of us have it figured out. But we can look to him and see that rest. I don't need to get unburdened to come to Jesus. I don't. My burden is actually what qualifies me to come. That's who he comes gentle and lowly to. He doesn't come that way towards the Pharisee, to those who think they've got it all together. He comes to those who says, the faith is the only requirement, and it's my grace that fulfills the requirement that is on you. I will give you rest. Whether you're actively working hard, which for some of you, I know how hard you work. For some of you, you are actively laboring to make your life easier. Or those who are finding themselves weighed down by something. Man, the things that we get weighed down with and the joy that it is to walk with you guys in that. And I'll say that. It is not a burden the pastor carries. It is a delight to walk with you through some of the lightest and some of the heaviest moments. Because we walk together in this. And we learn how to live a little bit lighter and a little freer. See, he opens his heart up to us. Christ desires that you might find rest. Do you know that about him? That he wants you to calm down. He wants you to take a rest. He wants you to get a nap and a snack and relax. He wants you to actually take a rest, to be at peace. I have a gift for you today. It is not just the message. It's a better message that put me in a place of tears. So whatever is said about the author or not, no, it's not my book. It is a book I read that while I sat up at Badger Pass, I just wept. Because it's the invitation to say, you don't have to try so hard. You don't have to make it all happen. And so when you guys leave, there's a book by Dan Ortlund called Gentle and Lowly. Man, I encourage you to read it. It is a great message. It is a great message of, man, being a disciple, being somebody who's walking and following Jesus. He says this, gentle and lowly. This, according to his own testimony, is Christ's very heart. This is who he is. He is tender. He is open. He is welcoming. He is accommodating. He's understanding. He is willing. If we are asked to say only one thing about who Jesus is, we would be honoring Jesus' own teaching if we said that he is gentle and lowly. If you came to church for the first time, I want to do more than just invite you to one service. I know that doesn't just mean come every Sunday. Please fill this out. I want to actually get to know you. Our staff here, it's more than one person can carry. Not just our staff, but those who have been leading and serving in this church, they genuinely actually want to know you. They celebrate that you're here. And so fill this out, and I want to invite you back next week. We are actually going to be having something called SP Connect, Sierra Pines Connect. We try to acronym everything. I don't know why. But we're going to be in between services. So even if you are like, I don't know if I'm going to go to another service, that guy was long and drawn out, that we still want to honor you with a burrito and bless you. We have coffee cups today, too. If you haven't gotten one of our awesome coffee cups and you're new with us, man, please take time. But the point is, because you deserve to see that Christ makes an entrance into your life. And last time I checked, the way he does that is through one another. Last time I saw is that Jesus shows up in people's lives because somebody was willing to say, I love you, and you're worth it. You're worthy of my time. You're worthy of my schedule. You're worthy of all of it because, man, we throw a party because he's worthy. Amen? Okay. So I look at what you might know that, you know, Christ died, that he rose again on my behalf to forgive us of all sin, that his deepest heart for you, what he would want you to know today is that he wants you to live easy and light, not burdened, not weighed down anymore. He wants you to walk out of here lighthearted. Honestly, where we're going to go for the next however long the Lord determines is living lightly and freely, because God is reminding me to lighten up, and God is reminding the church to lighten up, that if you live lightly and freely, people see that and they say, why are you living that way in the world that's so heavy? You guys had enough heavy? Have you had enough heavy? Like, I don't know about you, I turn on TV, like before I even scroll, there is heavy everywhere I look. But to have an invitation to a burdenless life. See, it's too heavy. There's too many burdens that have been placed on you. And so I want to remind you that Jesus, he called out those who were not gentle and lowly. He called out the Pharisee and said, you experts in the law, woe to you. It's not a good word. When you hear Jesus say woe, W-O-E, okay? It is not a shocking wow. It is woe, doom to you. Pharisees, experts in the law, because you load people down with burdens they can hardly carry. See, I've seen somebody who's carrying too many burdens. I've seen somebody who has not realized the gift that is grace, trying to carry it all on their own. I've seen people place burdens on others. It's not just about Jesus and the cross and his life, death, and resurrection. You also have to do this, this, and this. Have you had that added onto you? If I've done anything to add those things onto you, no. It is about the grace of Jesus. It is about the truth of the gospel, which is it makes my life light and burdenless, free of burden. Because if I do have a burden, I can cast it on him. If I do have a burden, I have brothers and sisters that can help me carry it, that I'm not heavy laden. Instead of being somebody that loads people down with burdens that they can hardly carry, and you yourself will not lift one finger to help. See, Pharisees load people down with burdens. Followers of Jesus lift burdens off. They take restraints or restriction off, and they say, there is Jesus who will lead you in grace. Now, I know it seems a little bit scary to preach this way, but especially on Easter, because there's so many things that are permissible, right? There's so many things that are like, oh, well, then I'm good, right? Do you know what I'm talking about? Like, oh, just live that way. Just do your life. You do you. All that. No, I believe that grace changed my life. I believe it wasn't grace and. I believe that grace was the thing that changed my life so much that I was like, I don't want any of that other stuff. That stuff actually weighs me down. I don't need to be told what not to do. I already know what not to do, and it feels pretty fun. But it leaves me with this hangover. It leaves me with this weight. It leaves me with shame. It leaves me with guilt, and I don't want that burden anymore. And I don't want that burden on you. And so Jesus says, let me show you how grace will alleviate the burden. Take off that weight. See, this verse about my yoke is easy, my burden is light. We don't, insert really lame Easter joke here, yoke, okay? Okay, there you go. Now, yoke was actually the burden of a beast of burden. We would place it over an oxen. It was a methodology of saying, this is the teaching of a rabbi. This is what we believe. And Jesus is saying, the only thing, the only way I want you to apply the Torah, the law and the prophets, the only way I want you to apply it is to see that I'm gentle and lowly in heart. The way I want you to apply it is to see, look, it can be light and free. It can be easy. It can be, well, as Eugene Peterson says, walk with me. Watch how I do it. Work with me. Watch how I do it. Because when I look at Jesus, I see unforced rhythms of grace. Jesus lived an interruptible life. He was on his way to the cross, and somebody calls out for help, and he responds. He lived lightly and freely. He had nothing. He had nowhere to lay his head, and yet he had everything. And when it comes to laying down your burden today, cast your burden on the Lord, release it. Ball up your fist. Just do it for a moment, okay? We ball up our fists. We kind of like hold on really tightly. Release it. Release it. It says, he will sustain and uphold you. He will never allow the righteous to be shaken. They won't fall. They won't slip. They won't fail. So how do I make entrance? If we're going to walk into someday, I believe this life is very, very brief. I'm 42 already. My daughter's 13. I don't even know what happened. I don't. But I look at my life and I go, okay, Lord, I've got maybe 40 years, maybe. What am I going to do with it? I just celebrated with one of my friends just turned 40, and they're like, oh my gosh. I'm like, just wait. Two more years, and it's really going to settle in. You know, and then you guys always remind me, oh, yeah, you're young. I'm like, I don't feel it. And it happens so quick. How will I make entrance into heaven? How will I make an entrance? Right? I won't be the center of attention. You guys know that's one of the best parts about heaven. I won't be the center of attention. For some of you, this long and drawn out sermon keeps going. It is, yes, thank God. He will not be the center of attention. More importantly, Jesus, who is the center of attention, makes you the object of his affection, that he will look at you and not add another requirement. Oh, you didn't get this right. Oh, you failed here. Oh, here, let me play on the movie screen all the ways you failed and messed up. No, his eyes on you, because when God sees you, he sees the finished work on the cross. When God sees you and the requirements that are needed for me to live holy and righteous and right, he sees his son in me. He sees the perfect work of the cross. He says, the life, death, and resurrection, what you put your faith in, come on in. You lived way too burdened in this life. I wanted you to live lightly and freely. It's okay, though, because this is where you'll live light and free. So if you have yet to make him Lord, if you've yet to say, man, I want to know that I can make entrance into the very promise of God, when he makes entrance into your life, everything changes. Anybody whose life was changed, say amen to that? Amen. When Jesus enters into our lives, everything changes. Psalm 68:19, blessed be the Lord. Day after day, he bears our burdens. God is our salvation. And that word is a rest, Salah. It's a rest. He is our salvation. Let him make entrance into your life. I promise you, you'll be met with a God who is gentle and lowly. He's lowly in heart. He will lift off any ill-fitted burden off of you. I'm going to ask the team to come back up, because out of all days, there's always a opportunity on a Sunday to respond. But as I invite the team back up, Brandon said, we're going to go out loud. And I said, that's awesome. Because if anybody puts their faith in Jesus, it says in heaven they throw a party. They throw a huge celebration. And sometimes we make church way too subdued and way too quiet. We shout louder at a ball game, right? Opening day, I'm yelling at a screen. I've only been involved in this sport for like 1 year because my kid's in Little League, okay? And all of a sudden, I'm like cheering for the athletics, which really shows that I'm broken and need Jesus. But in this moment of, I want to respond. I want to make entrance into heaven, and I want him to make entrance into my life. What it looks like is simply putting your faith in Jesus, who literally fulfilled every requirement. When it comes to lifting every heavy or ill-fitted requirement on you, every crippling burden that you feel like you've had to carry on your own. See, for some in this room, I know your stories, and you feel like you still have to try and do it alone. The church is made up of people to actually help carry that burden. If you're on the prayer team, just hit the sidewalls. And if you want to put your faith in Jesus and know a lighter for your life, it is simple. Jesus, you died for me. You died on my behalf. I want you to make entrance into my life. I want you to change my life because I can't keep carrying this burden anymore. I can't just be laboring in vain because all of a sudden my money means nothing. Inflation has hit and doesn't even matter. I keep working, and it doesn't feel like it ever gets to anything. And even if you have met all of the requirements and you like lived the life and provided for your kids and everything, all of a sudden it's like, what was it all for? Man, I want to encourage you. There's a crippling burden of sin on every single one of us that walks in here. Sin is the reminder of the things I run to for identity, the things I run to for purpose, the things I run to that are empty. They're never going to satisfy. They're never going to be enough. So every single one in here carries the burden of sin. Every single one of us has carried a level of, man, I don't know how to carry this anymore. I truthfully do not know how to carry this anymore. I need him and I need you. We need the grace of God to change our lives. And so if you haven't put your faith in Jesus, man, I can point at historical reasons. I can point at all, no, but what you need is to meet a Jesus who's gentle and lowly in heart, who understands right where you're at and what you've been going through. So you might not be the center of attention, but you are the object of his affection. I don't care how long you've been at church. He still fixes his eyes on you and says he loves you. That the Father, that's a whole nother level. There are some dads in this room, some phenomenal dads in this room, to say, I would give my one and only son for that one, for that one, for that one. I give my one and only son so that they might live lightly and freely. That's the gospel. And when you enter heaven, if you put your faith in Jesus, when you enter heaven, all eyes are going to be on him. Make no mistake. This is not a self-centered gospel, you guys. All eyes will be on him forever, all eternity. And where are his eyes? Fixed on you. They made it. They put their faith in me. They realized it was enough. You were the joy that was set before him. So while every eye is closed, every head is bowed, we're just going to bow our heads. It's a reverence. Honestly, this is between you and the Lord. I'm not even going to peek. it's kind of a thing in church. It's like, oh yeah, I was the first to open my eyes. We want to be responsible to you and for you. We want to walk alongside you if you put your faith in Jesus. And so please, talk to somebody. Go to the prayer team and pray a prayer. Fill out the card. But know that this is not about just building the church. This is about you and salvation. So while our eyes are closed, Lord, we see you. You are gentle and lowly. You come to us in humility. And you know how to make an entrance. When you rose from the dead, you changed all of human history. So Lord, right now, in the privacy, in the place where someone is unsettled because they've worked too hard, when they've been burdened down with sin, first remind them they're not alone. That whatever sin they found themselves in, trying to gain identity, trying to feel like enough, trying to feel loved or safe, that God, you already saw it and you forgave it. You carried that weight on the cross so they wouldn't have to be burdened anymore. So Lord, if there's those in this room that want to make that decision, just pray this prayer with me. Lord, I confess that you are Lord. I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth right now. Even if it's quietly, even if it's softly, I confess with my mouth that Christ is Lord, that you lived, you died, and you rose from the dead. And that every day you will carry my burden. And every day, Jesus, you are my salvation. Lord, thank you for the one that is unsettled by that, who's afraid that that prayer was not enough. I pray that you remind them that that was more than enough, because it is faith in the cross. It is faith in the grace that you have towards us. We love you, Jesus, and we celebrate you as the risen Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, make sure you tell someone if you've made that decision. There's people on the sides, even if you just want to pray, man, I want to live freely and lightly, that you take the time to go and pray with somebody. We're going to celebrate big, because when you throw Jesus a party, he's worthy. So go ahead and stand to your feet. He's risen.
Song forever ending in the end.
your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name.
Understand how much he loves you, that you are the object of his affection. I pray that you show people more than just saying he's risen. You want to show people he's risen indeed. Live gently and lowly. Live with your heart open, saying, inviting people in, loving people the way they are, and inspiring them. See, this church is an incredible thing. I do love this church. I want to see this church where we got to go back to three services and everything else. But most importantly, more higher than anything else, is that Jesus is made Lord in your life. And when he comes back, he's not coming back subtly this time. And I don't know when that is. It seems like it's quickening. It seems like it could happen any day. Do not walk out of here without feeling a sense that Jesus made entrance into your life so that you might make entrance into heaven. You hear me? Now I'm serious as a heart attack. Now I'm taking myself real serious. But because it is your eternity that matters. That is what matters. There is no requirement that has not been met on the cross. And he burst out of the grave to show you resurrection will happen. He's risen. God bless you guys. Have a happy Easter. Make sure to grab your gift on the way out. And if you're new, please get a coffee cup, man. We love you. Stay as long as you want, but make sure you tell somebody you love them before you leave, huh? I love you guys.